This is an introductory presentation to the module 011, dealing with advances in broadband technologies. The aim of this presentation is to discuss, to review and list some networking and transmission system concepts that will be very useful when going through the basic and advanced module of this section, I mean of this 011. So the presentation consists of several sections where we first go through the network concept, what is a network. We'll also go through the bitrate concept and its relation with the broadband term and broadband networking. Then we'll go more detail with some networking general concepts and protocol and network architecture to come out the standard model used to design networks, which is the International Standard Organization standard related with open system interconnection. Finally, we'll go through several well-known internet protocols, and at the end we'll review very quickly the different pills that will integrate the two submodules of 011, the basic submodule and the advanced submodule. Let's start with the network concept. What is a network? A network is a set of devices and interconnection infrastructures that enable communications between devices using transmission systems and communication protocols. Transmission systems and communication protocols, which are the main aspects we just mentioned, required to understand the more basic and advanced concept related with networking. Which are the main rationality behind the network or the networking concept? So in other words, why connecting devices and is connecting devices useful or beneficial for us? So why connecting devices? To obtain some aspects, to obtain some features that then will provide some benefits. For instance, sharing resources, like sharing storage systems, sharing networks, sharing computers. All these aspects can be done using a network. Sharing information, and a clear example is the website access. So if you go to a website, you cannot be the only one, so several users can go through a website and share information, documents that are allocated there. So this cannot be done without a network. Also, a reliability improvement, it's another important concept. This concept deals with the protection and restoration in front of failures. In fact, the networking rationality, or the main concept behind networking, is to facilitate communications between people, communities, computer, etc. Is this beneficial for us, doing all these infrastructures connected, connecting computers and so on? For instance, just some statements can clearly define or clearly put on the table that this is beneficial for the society. This using networking can increase the available information and coordination. It's clear, because we are sharing information and resources. It can decrease the cost of some tasks, communication tasks, for instance. You don't need to visit your neighbor to say something or tell something to him or her. You just need to send a mail, for instance. This can increase the efficiency of the human being activities, and of course can reduce the time response in front of incidences or changes, increase the productivity, and so on. Which are the basic elements of a network? There are three basic elements in a network: the nodes, which are interconnecting links, the links, which are allocating communication channels, and the communication channels, which are transporting the information from one point to another, or from one point to some others, point and two-point communications and multi-point communications. So communication channel can be symmetric or asymmetric. Symmetric is that communication channel that can have the same capacity, communication capacity in both directions, while asymmetric channel has different capacity in both directions. A typical example of an asymmetric channel can be the web browsing. If a user or person, any person wants to obtain some document or information or movie or whatever from a website, the user only requires to send a couple of messages, control messages requiring the information and which information is desired, and then this means you don't need much capacity to do that. But in the other way, the website has to send us the document we have requested. So this means that probably we will need more capacity to download this information quickly. At the same time, the communication channels can be divided in unidirectional and bidirectional. Unidirectional, also known as simplex channels, are those channels that only can send or can transport information in one direction, while bidirectional can transport information in both directions. The bidirectional channels also can be divided in half duplex and full duplex. Although you can get the communication channel, the bidirectional communication channel can transport information in both directions. At the same time, half duplex channels only can transport information in one direction. The other direction is controlled by a scheduling mechanism, for instance, like something similar like to a traffic light. So both directions are available, but only one at the same time. And of course, the full duplex channel is that channel that uses bidirectional channel that can use both directions at the same time. Information can be sent at the same time in both directions. In order to divide a link in several channels, one important device is the multiplexer. Multiplexing is the way we have to divide a channel, sorry, a link in different communication channels. So the most typical mechanisms for multiplexing information in a link or dividing a link in several channels is frequency division multiplexing, where you allocate different carriers, different frequency carriers, and you send information overlapped, because are sent in different bandwidth channels, different bands, frequency bands. Another possibility is time division multiplexing. That means that the information of any user is transported at a particular point of time. So the information sent by different users are not overlapped, because each user or each input port of a multiplexer is allowed to transmit at a different point of in time. Once we know that, the question is how communication channels can work. Communication channel is based on transmission systems, and the key aspect of a transmission system is the transmission media. So data transmission occurs between a transmitter and a receiver through a transmission media. That means that the transmission media is the support for transporting information from one point to another, or from one point to several points, point to point, and point to multipoint communication again. So the transmission media can be wired or guided, and wireless or unguided. In wired transmission media, waves are guided along a solid medium, such as transmission line. Examples of transmission media, guided transmission media, or wired transmission media, are twisted pairs, coupled twisted pairs, coaxial cables, or optical fibers, while in a wireless transmission media, transmission is done or achieved by means of an antenna. Antenna at the transmitter, an antenna, another antenna at the receiver, or receivers in case of point multipoint. Examples of this type of transmission media are microwave, radio, links, or infrared communication. Another important concept associated with transmission media is the type of data or signal that these transmission media are transmitting. We can divide these signals in two types, analog and digital. Analog transmission, it takes the form of continuous signal transmitted over a medium at a certain frequency range. Well, that means that there are any value in the signal is allowed. While digital transmission sends data in form of bits or in form of discrete values, more than two can be allowed. So that means that not all the values are allowed, only some of them. At the same time, it's important to distinguish in the transmission in a transmission media can be serial or parallel. Serial means that the signal is transmitted. Let's consider, for instance, a digital transmission is transmitted that the data bit stream is transmitted one bit after the other. That means in a continuous stream. Parallel transmission allows, considering the same example, so bit transmission or data bits transmission, allows to transmit several bits at the same time. So that means that there are several channels in the transmission media allocated. Finally, and but not less important, is the concept of capacity or bandwidth or bit rate. Capacity of a transmission media is the speed that this transmission media can have to transmit information. How fast this transmission media can transmit information, or how much information per second can transmit this information media. Typically, in an analog transmission, the capacity is considered or is named as bandwidth, and in digital transmissions, capacity is usually named as bit rate, but both are synonymous. Capacity, bandwidth, and bit rate are synonymous, especially in these discrete communications. So, going through these aspects, so how much information can a transmission media send per second, for instance, we can divide the networks or the systems that include transmission media in broadband and not broadband. Broadband networks or broadband systems are those who have a bit rate higher than 2 megabits per second, so that means that less than 2 megabits per second we not consider broadband systems. More than 2 or equal, it's the border for considering a system broadband. Okay, so now we know the concepts of what is a network, what is bitrate, what is a broadband network, that network that allows to transmit information at higher bitrates of 2 megabits per second. So let's jump to the concept to a network in general, to the more detailed concepts related with the networking panorama. And first of all, we will try to do network classification. This network classification, of course, we can have many more items, but here we have selected the following. Broadcast network or broadcast networks are those networks that broadcast information from one point to several or many users. Typical case is TV, commercial TV, or Ethernet, or have either based coaxial or hub based Ethernet in a local environment. Switched networking is that network that uses switches to route the information from one point to another destination, trying to find out at any moment the best route or the best path. Best meaning less cost, less nodes, less hubs, whatever. Typical examples of this switched network are the plain switched telephone network, the switched Ethernet, so interconnection of local area networks based on Ethernet, and of course Internet, which the switches are called routers. Also, another important concept to classify the network is the access network. The access networks are these networks that allow the user interconnected to or connected to these networks to access to the core network or a main network. Examples of these access networks are Ethernet. Typically, Ethernet is an access network. Wi-Fi, wireless access network. ADSL, asynchronous digital subscriber loop, or fiber to the home networks. On the other hand, we have the backbone, or also known as transport networks, which are the core of a big network. These networks are typically used to transport information from one access network to another. Typical examples of these backbone networks are SDH, Synchronous Digital Hierarchy, or a set of dedicated circuits, frame relay, MPLS, multi-protocol label switching, carrier Ethernet, etc. All these networks are also known as transport networks because are supporting the internet network or the interconnection of IP routers. According to the coverage, the networks can be classified as local area networks, LAN, metropolitan area network, MAN, wide area networks, WAN, desktop area networks, DAN, personal area networks, etc. According to the relation between the entities or the applications, this is a concept more related with the application supported by networks, but also important concept for classifying the networks, it's client-server networks and peer-to-peer networks. Client-server networks divide the nodes in clients and servers, the external nodes. And peer-to-peer networks, all the users or external nodes connected to the network are providing services, can be at the same time either clients or servers. So typical examples of that, the client-server networks are client-server network is that providing email service or web service, while peer-to-peer network can provide Skype or BitTorrent services. Continuing with the description of concepts related with network, we have the network topology concept. It means the way that the nodes and links are organized. So according to this, we have several possible topologies. The most typical ones are bus, ring, star, extended star, hierarchical, also known as tree topology, and mesh networks. Typically, tree or hierarchical and mesh topologies are used in the core networks or in the backbone networks, while bus, ring, star, or extended star are used in local area networks or wide area networks, or metropolitan area networks. What kind of devices can we find in a network? From more or less complex to more complex, we can find amplifiers, which are electronic devices that amplify the signal. these systems or these devices allow allow us to increase the reachability of a link. The bad news are that at the same time that amplifies the signal we want to transmit, they also amplifies the noise. So we can not reduce the bit error rate using amplifiers. On the other hand, hub, it's a similar concept, electronic device with a number of ports used in a LAN typically, in Ethernet in fact, is the most typical way place, but it's in this case is a regenerator. We can extend this concept of the hub to a regenerator. Regenerator is at the same time a system device that can extend the reachability of a link in a multi-port hub. What the signal incoming from one port is distributed or broadcasted to the rest of the ports. But the good news here is that the bits are reshaped. So in some way there is the possibility to filter the noise. Routers and switches are the most important elements in a network. In fact, routers are the names that receive the switches in an IP network. Electronic devices used to ensure messages are sent to their intended destination. So these devices are smart, so they have a capacity of selecting and looking at the information packets they distribute and send the information only from one input port to only the output port that goes to the right destination. A more complex type of switch is a bridge, which consists a hardware or a software, or a hardware plus a software that allows communications between two similar networks. For instance, a bridge is used to interconnect. Ethernet switch is a bridge that allows to interconnect two hub Ethernet segments. On the other hand, a gateway consists of a hardware or a software or a hardware with a software that allows communication between not similar networks, different from one to each other. For instance, interconnecting Ethernet with internet requires a gateway. Now we come to the second part of this introductory presentation that wants to discuss the main concepts that will be required to follow the rest of this module or module 011. And here we find the concept of protocols and network architecture. Here we will discuss, let's consider this as a second part of this presentation, and here we will deal with problems in communication networks. These problems will let us see that there is a need for communication protocols to solve these problems. Then we will discuss or we'll review the layer model and protocols, the concept of protocols and the type of architectures we can find based on this layered model we will mention here. What kind of problems we can find in communication networks? So networks are very complex systems. They are multitude of problems must be solved because of they are complex. So to mention some of them, we'll refer for instance to the node identification, node or internal nodes or external nodes. This is necessary, either internal or external. This is also called as addressing, so we have to name the different nodes in order to be able to tell the network where we want to send this information. Find the way to the destination. This is a really very important mechanism to be install in a network. This is also called as routing. Ensure the correct transmission of the information. This enclose how to transmit error-free information. So we need error control mechanisms. Control the communication. So like we do in the traffic of cars. So kind of traffic lines to control information and make it more efficient. This is in the case of network, these are called flow control mechanisms. And also for controlling the flow in a link. But if we extend this concept to a network, we need to control not only the flow, but also the congestion. How many packets do we allow to have inside the network in such a way that the network is not congested? So this is something important to have in a network. We also have the concept of channel, or the problem of channel sharing. For instance, in a local area network, interconnecting different devices or different nodes through a same media, transmission media, we need to avoid collisions, or to guarantee that when one node is transmitting, the other are in silence. So this can be done thanks to medium access control mechanisms. Interconnection of different networks also is an important aspect, because require compatibility of transmission formats. This is another problem, important problem to be solved. Reaction to failures, really not very well known, but one of the most important problems to be handled by the operators, network providers. This is called as resilience mechanisms. And finally, it's day by day more and more important, as much the applications, internet applications are used, the privacy and the information confidentiality. So there are, of course, other problems to handle in a communication network, but this is this point enough to see that the important thing here is how to cope with this problem. We need to develop a set of rules, right? The congestion control mechanisms are set of rules in such a way that the access points of a network can control the number of packets or the number of connections that are allowed at any moment, just as an example. So this set of rules can handle, as I say, traffic management, when start and ending a communication session, how connecting and disconnecting devices from a network or networks among them, security transmission, and so on. This set of rules is what we call protocols. So a protocol is a set of rules governing the exchange of messages between two or multiple entities that communicate with each other to ensure that the feasibility of this communication is guaranteed. This is what refers to protocols. We have defined a protocol, but then we have network architecture, how we compose or build up a network. So we have to decide what kind of architecture we use, how to interconnect nodes, how to interconnect, which topology to use, which kind of protocols to apply at any segment of the network. So usually there is a architecture of reference, which is standardized by the International Standard Organization body. And this standard is called Open System Interconnection. The Open System Interconnection is an overall architecture required to communicate between computers. So it's for defining a computer network, which is in fact what we are talking about all the time. Open System Interconnection can be seen in two ways, as a standard or as a reference model. both of the ways can be seen. I mean, not in one way or another. Can be seen in two ways at the same time. So it's in fact a standard that can be used as a reference. That means that we use this architecture as a reference for designing new networks, not using the model to be copied exactly, but as a reference. Open System Interconnection is a reference model that shows how a message should be transmitted between nodes in a data network. And the Open System Interconnection model has 7 layers or levels. That means that each layer cope with a different functionality. Not all existing networks, as I said, adhere to the Open System Interconnection model. So, but all the existing networks use this model as a reference. It is very useful as a teaching model and to solve problems in technical discussion. As I said, it is provided by the International Standard Organization, ISO. What is Open System Interconnection Architecture based? The main idea is that the process of communication between two users in a telecommunication network can be divided into levels or layers, as I said, which perform independent tasks. Each layer performs an independent task. When we say user in a telecommunication network, we also can say users in a computer network. So the main aspects that defines this open system interconnection architecture is that the lower layers are serving the upper layers, and the protocols regulate the communication between the entities of the same layer. So transmission is done in vertical from the upper layer to down to the lower layers, and virtually each layer is doing a communication among them. Here we have a figure, picture that describes the different functionalities performed at each of these 7 layers. The upper layer is the one that is directly in touch with the user. So application layer is connected to the final user with a user interface. The presentation layer deals with data formatting. The session layer deals with the establishing and maintain the connection, and the transport layer deals with the reliability of the transmission point to point, or better to say end to end transmission. So layer 4, 5, 6 and 7 are end to end, covering end to end transmission, while network, data link and physical are network, in fact, is related with the communication with the access router. The access router in a core network among them. So, and it relates with the control of the functionality of the network, of the core network. Data link is related with the access link to the core networks. Can be a point-to-point link or can be an access network like an Ethernet. That's why medium access control protocol and switches functionalities are allocated in this layer 2. And physical deals with transmission system, so deals with what kind of signals, cables, modulations have to be used to transmit the information from the users to the first node of a network. This is an interesting comparison of the Open System Interconnection standard 7-layer model with the Internet Protocol Suite. As you can see, it's the Internet Protocol Suite refers to the Open System Interconnection, but it's not exactly the same. So layer 5, 6 and 7 are integrated in a single one, application level. Layer 4 it's defined to transport two type of signals, streaming and packet, connectionless packet distribution, TCP is supporting this transmission, this transport, and UDP supports the bit streaming transport. IP deals with the networking functionalities, routing, addressing, and so on. And layer 1 and 2 are undefined. In fact, depends of the access network and the core network supporting or where the internet is supported. Just to review some of the well-known internet protocols, we can mention the file transfer protocol. This protocol is placed in the application layer and used to transmit files. Hypertext transfer protocol, also located in the application layer, application protocol for distribute collaborative hypermedia information systems in the foundation of data communication for the web. In fact, this is the protocol that governs the web access. Simple mail transfer protocol is a protocol governing the email application. Wireless application protocol, it's enabling wireless devices to access and use the internet using a client server network. And then we have two protocols that are not typical internet but closely related with internet. IEEE 802.3, the standard Ethernet protocol, and IEEE 802.11, which is the standard for Wi-Fi protocol for wireless LAN technology. Here we have the book where all these concepts can be found, but also others. So if you want to extend information, basic information about what is a network, what is bitrate, how these networks work, how to build up networks, about the network protocols, network topologies, and so on. This is a really strong, we strongly recommend you to use this book. This is William Stalling's Data and Computer Communications. There is a 10th edition available, and it's edited or published by William Stalling's Books on Computer and Data Communications. So this is a very brief review of some concept of transmission systems and communication protocols and networking aspects. Now, to finish this introductory presentation, we will quickly list the type of content that you will find in the other two modules of OU11. One is the basic module, and it contains conventional access network divided in two pills, two short presentations, one devoted to wired access technologies and the other to wireless access technologies, and the backbone networks, conventional also backbone network, which includes three pills, three short presentations: the introduction to backbone networks, the functionality within internet, in fact, layer 2 and layer 1 technologies. So what kind of backbone networks are typically in place nowadays to support signals and transport the bit stream, and what kind of layer 2 technologies, including switching capabilities and so on, are in place to support the internet. For what regards to the advanced module, it contains again two submodules, one devoted to access networks and the other to backbone networks, but going to the advanced access network, more advanced concepts, and the advanced backbone networks. In this case, for the advanced access network, we have two pills, two short presentations, one devoted to fiber to the home, fiber to the building, fiber to the cabinet, fiber to the neighborhood, whatever, fiber to the X means different endpoints. One pill is related to the market and economics of this type of fiber to the network or technologies, and the other is discussing the technology and the architectures mainly used. The second section of this advanced module regards to advanced backbone networks, and it includes three short presentations. One devoted to elastic optical networks, the other to the optical packet switching, and finally one very hot topic, which is software-defined networking applied to the core networks, the backbone networks. This introductory presentation has been prepared by jointly by Jaume Comellas and Josep Soler Pareta, both of the Telecommunication School, Electrical Engineering of the UPC, and the narrator of this presentation has been Josep Soler Pareta. Thank you, and continue with the other modules.